Michał is right, I'm Emilka Bojańczyk, and I am a graphic designer, so a bit different than many, probably most of you. Okay, so I'm a graphic designer, as I said, and I work in a graphic design studio called Podpunkt, and we design a lot of printed things also, but and that's where our roots are. But a couple of years ago, we started branching out to digital design also, and first of all, it was this kind of waterfall work that we designed a website, then we gave over the specs to developers, and that's the end of our work. And there wasn't a lot of communication going on at all between designers and developers. Right now, I co-founded also Superskrypt, which is a digital agency, and it's based on the premise that designers and developers have to work together hand in hand, and that when the communication occurs, this really can lead to a lot better results. And in Superskrypt, we do a lot of web design, and we make the websites which are designed from A to Z, and which don't use a lot of ready components. So that's maybe where we differ from many of the things that the previous talks were about, because we don't use out-of-the-box solutions. And our customers come to us for bespoke design and a bit of a more artistic approach. So there's communication between designers and coders, but the fact is that we're different. We have different backgrounds, we have different education, and we look at the project that we're working on in different ways. And you don't have to take my word for it, because the internet also thinks that these are different people. You know, when you type in designer into Google Images, this is the guy that appears, and this is a coder, according to the internet. So you can definitely see that these are different people, and communication is not always going to be very easy. So during this process, and we try to right now to have the design process and the coding process in parallel, so we have a lot of talking and a lot of questions, and the coders ask questions and the designers have questions. But when it turns out that we speak a bit of a different language, or even worse, the worst situation is when we speak the same words but we understand different things behind those words, and then the communication is not so very easy and a lot of misunderstandings happen. So today I'd like to point out a few of the misunderstandings that we've had in our team over in my experience at Superskrypt. And one of the first topics that I'd like to talk about is the notion of done, and we want to develop in stages. We want to show the client the project in cycles. But when can we suspect that a phase is finished enough to show to the client, for instance, or finished enough to go on to a different phase? So this is something that I think designers and developers have a bit of a different point of view on this, because for a designer, coherency is very, very important. And for the client to understand, the idea behind the project is very, very important. And consistency also is very important for the graphic design. So we don't want to show something to the client that we feel does not show the concept or doesn't have this overall feeling that we really want to convey. On the other hand, for developers, and especially ones who want to work in an agile way, they want to have quick loops of testing and feedback, and every time they have a piece of working software, they want to show it to the client. So this has led, for instance, in our team to some misunderstandings. An example of that would be, we were working on a website, and one of the key, visual aspects of the site at the very in a banner at the very top was an animated infographic showing the key qualities of the client, like infographics, and this was supposed to be animated. It was like a, this gentle journey that we invited the user to join, and the client saw a mock-up of this and accepted this idea, and all was fine. But then I went for a week of vacation, and the developer team was working, they were working on the project, and they had some components that they wanted to show to the client, which were like way below this banner. But they also started working on some aspects of this animation, and what they, when the client opened the link that they sent him, the visual aspect was generally something like this. Now, I'm not showing you what they actually showed to the client because I don't have it anymore, but I think this was the reaction. The reaction that the client had was like generated by something approximately comparable to this. So we got a lot of negative feedback from the client that this site causes epilepsy and that this whole concept is wrong and that we have to go back to, you know, the designing stage and think of something different for this place. And of course, the, as a designer, I was unhappy about this because, well, it put the whole basic concept in jeopardy. But on the other hand, you know, the development team thought that, well, they were just showing a piece of working software to the client, and it's obvious that we've got cycles and we're working on things, so what's the big deal? So I think the takeaway from this would be that it's important to show the client different phases, but it's also very important to sometimes not show something to the client, because it's very difficult to unsee something and forget what you saw. And it took us, I think, from a couple of weeks to maybe even a month or two to just get the client to forget what he saw there and persuade them that this whole idea is not something that should be thrown away because he saw something unfinished. A different topic that would be structure. And we all have this mental map, I think, of the project that we're working on. But I suspect that these mental maps from the designer's point of view and the developer's point of view are quite different. So I don't know if all of designers feel this way, but when I design something, I feel like, you know, this maybe small, but a kind of god that opens up his file, and inside the file I see like building blocks which I can arrange in almost any way. Of course, there are constraints, so I need to I need to work with the constraints that the client has given us. I need to use the grid, maybe I need to follow certain rules. But out of these blocks, I can build practically, you know, I can arrange them in very, very many different ways, and there's a lot of possibilities. And if for some reason, for instance, during a meeting with a client, I feel that this maybe doesn't belong here, or the client says that he doesn't want this here, you know, it's really not a big deal for me to push it somewhere else. Like, there's the hole that appears, so like we think, well, why not stretch this part here, and we've got a different layout. And then I go over in like a desk over to the programmers and I say, you know, these little tiny changes, like only two changes, and we swap this little thing, and you know, no big deal. But when I go over to the developers, I feel like we sit down before their monitor, and there's this, I feel like this little ant that's looking up at the lines and lines of code. So it's a completely different feeling from the one I have when I look down into my files and the cursor is somewhere over here, and she shows me that to take this box and move it over there, we would have to unwrap it from one container and then from the other container and then from the other one. And it's basically the process of unwrapping something from five boxes and then wrapping it into five different boxes again. So probably when you show it in a different way, the structure of a designer's file and thus the mental map that the designer makes of the project would be really of very, very low depth, meaning that most of the elements are interchangeable, and it's not really a very big problem to swap a lot of the elements. Whereas with the programmers, they are constrained by the actual structure of the code and the, for instance, structure of the website, And the, you know, it usually forms a tree, usually not, maybe not a binary tree, but even a more complicated one. And the depth is quite big. So sometimes you get lucky and you can change these things and it's not a very big problem, but sometimes to change this and this, you'd have to go all the way up to the root to do that. And it's just, I think that designers usually don't have a way of knowing what the actual structure of the data and the behind these components is, but I think it's really important to know that there is such a structure and that you need to consult these things with the developers as you go. You shouldn't promise things to the client that then turn out to be really complicated, and you shouldn't suppose that it's really not a big deal to change something that looks really very easy. For instance, I don't know, an Illustrator or or Sketch. So also concerning structure would be consistency. And consistency is something that's very, very important for designers, of course. But it's also important for developers, and it enables developers to work in an effective way and to get along with the project. But as designers, we tend to think about consistency in styles and how things look, that they need to look the same. But for developers, I think that the data is even more important and the kind of data that's behind these things. So maybe on an example, I was working on a website that consisted, a lot of the sub pages of the site consisted of blocks, and these blocks were really very, very consistent. So they had, you know, they always had something, some text on the bottom, and this text was always typeset in the exact same font, and there was always a line, and sometimes there was a photo, and sometimes there was an icon, but on the, apart from that, these were really like very consistent building blocks. And this subpage consists of links to other subpages of this website, which were gathered here using some kind of tag. So this is like a site that gathers all the subpages concerning a student, say. So you can click on all of these boxes, and then you, if you click here, you go to somewhere, and here you go somewhere else. So this was generated automatically from the subpages of the site, just using a certain tag. And when we were working on this project, the client came and asked, would it be possible at zero additional cost to make a subpage which would show all of the very important professors in our institution? So I was set on designing this thing with the components that we already programmed. And I designed something like this. So it shows like all these people that they wanted to show, and it says what their names are. But this was not supposed to be a page consisting of links to other pages, but just the page that the client would want to fill out in a CMS, write out all these names. So I went over to the programmers and I asked them, like, we've got this, can we turn it into this at zero cost? And it turned out that it's not the case, actually, because here we've got links that are generated automatically, whereas here we would want to have information that's typed in by the client in a CMS. And these are not links, so even though they look identically to the designer and, you know, it's just the same object practically, these turned out not to be the same object, and we actually couldn't, you know, do it within the scope of this project, but we did it later on. So also concerning the structure would be, you know, it's, you've got all of these objects and which you don't want to align, for instance, but the designer only thinks about visually where these objects are. For a developer, the structure behind the objects is important, and that's what he sees. So as an example, are these, what do you think? Well, for me, no. Yeah, I think probably and most people would consider that these aren't evenly spaced out. This is a problem that arises often if you want to have a menu that goes along the width of the whole screen, and you want to space it out evenly. And then these, I would say that these are. But when you go back to this example, because I was frustrated that many developers did it this way, and why? Well, the answer is quite simple. If you divide the screen into four equal parts and you center the text in each part, then you've got this very, very logical, normal structure that's obvious to a developer. But if you want to do it this way, what you need to do is measure these arbitrary widths, which are you know, determined by the font, and even change as you change the font size or even font, you know, the actual font, and you space them out. So also the gaps are also arbitrary and determined by this thing that is not at all logical for a developer. So yeah, in Superscript we do it this way now, but it wasn't so obvious from the start. And it's actually the harder way to do for a developer, and maybe the less even logical way to do it. Okay, so now about the grid. The grid is really very important for designers. It's like, you know, designing along the grid. It goes back to the 60s and the Swiss design style, and it lets you design hierarchies and text and information, so it's very, very important. And I know that the grid is also important for developers, so this is something that we have in common and we can build upon. But here also, it turned out that we it's the same, but it's different, so we treat it a bit differently. So when I have a layout that is based on a grid as a designer, I tend to, you know, think of it as aligning many objects to, you know, vertically and horizontally, so that they are aligned with each other. And it's very important that these gaps are the same, that the margins are, let's say, the same or consistent, and that the spaces between the columns, and this is called gutter in designer language, it's also the same. So like these are the constraints for a designer. But when a developer takes this layout, he first divides it into, you know, remember the tree that I was talking about of the structure of the whole project? Well, you have to divide it into components, so like maybe you have a header and then you have the columns. So then you start seeing that it was important for me that this gap and that gap is the same, but suddenly this gap is like part of this object, but that gap is in two different objects. So it's stops being so very straightforward. I mean, these are all things that you can resolve pretty easily, but you need to know that the structure, since the structure is a bit different, you have to pay attention to this. And also, this I think was a kind of misunderstanding that was going on for years and years, because first, when I didn't work with developers directly, but created specifications for developers, we used to always draw the grid and, you know, write down every pixel like this, and then we'd send it to the developers. Then they wouldn't do it really this way, and now I think I know why, because we did it the wrong way. So when a designer thinks about the grid, you mark the margin, then there's the column, then there's the like space between the columns, we call it the gutter, and then there's the column, gutter, and margin, okay. But But then I learned from my fellow developers that there's no such thing as space between something in, for developers. It has to be either the column with a padding, or it has to be part of something. So you don't have just something that is space between. And also, this was problematic for developers because you've got this column that has the gutter on one side and the margin on the left side, but then you've got this column that has the margin on the right side and the gutter on the left side, and then you've got these columns that have the gutter on both sides. So all of these elements are atypical in a sense, which creates problems. So what they were doing, they were really translating what the useless things that I sent them into something that would be useful for them. So how we do it in Superscript now is that we create specs like this. We worked on this with the developers, and this is actually a lot more helpful for them, even though it takes about the same time for us to create in the designing program. So it's really a good use of time to help them. So I guess this picture speaks for itself, but if you have any questions about how this grid works, it's just that the key thing here is that you have identical columns, and each of them needs to have the identical padding. So that means that you've got components that are identically the same. And then it's helpful also to describe the percentages more than the pixels, and it's also helpful to have always the percentage of the level, upper level, you know, so less calculations for the developers later on. And another quirk that I noticed would be something like this. For designers, the very, very basic building block is a frame, and the frame can have a stroke and a fill. Like, this is like the very basics. And when you apply the stroke, it's on both sides of the element. So for instance, if I have I've got nine frames here, and they are stacked in like this IKEA way, and each frame has a stroke of, let's say, 20 pixels. So you've got 10 pixels on this side and 10 pixels on that side. And this is the very default, normal way that most of the designing programs do it. So if you do it in Illustrator, or if you do it in design, like I do, but I know I'm the minority, this is what happens. But if you say to a developer that we've got 9 stacked frames, and let's have a 20 pixel stroke on each of them, this is what happens in the developer's world. So what you get is that the inside strokes are twice as thick as the outside strokes. So now for designers, this is a problem. I know that designers are strange, but this is a problem. So now that I know that there's this danger of things like this happening, I can work with developers to just, you know, so they do it in a different way that is maybe a bit more difficult for them, but it's possible, of course. But first you have to just know that this thing even exists. Okay, so now on to typography, which is a really like a favorite topic of mine, and I think it's important for many designers. And recently, the capabilities of the web regarding typography have really, really improved. So right now, it's possible to have very ambitious design-wise things on the web regarding typography. You've got web fonts, you've got really you can do lots of cool stuff with typography on the web. But also, it helps to have a common language. So I'm going to show you some of the basic concepts from a designer's vocabulary, let's say. So for a designer, the baseline, which is a line that goes on the, you know, on which the capital letters stand, this is very important. It's like a metric that defines where the letters really are. So this is the baseline. And then you've got some other lines which I marked in blue, which are not so very important. But then if you've got a couple of lines, one after the other, you've got the leading. And the leading is measured from one baseline to the next baseline. This is how designers do it, and this is how design programs usually handle this stuff. And then we've got some other terms that usually often get mixed up. You've got two ways of spacing individual letters. You've got kerning, and this is an optical spacing of letters that's usually within the programmed within the font, and it's used for pairs of letters to, you know, allow for the shapes of each letter. So when you've got a pair of round letters like the D and E, you have to space, pull them apart. But when you've got letters like A, then you have to pull it, you know, closer together. So this is for pairs of letters, and this is something that usually you don't have to touch, the font does it itself. But then you've got tracking, and this is what the tool you should use to have words that are, you know, spaced, or conversely, if you want to squeeze them, this just adds extra space consistently after each letter. And this is called tracking in most design programs. So back to the baseline. When we lay out text, it's very important. When you compose a layout for a designer, you work on something that is called the baseline grid. And the baseline grid is a grid of lines along the whole document, you know, done in a consistent way. And you attach all of the lines of text to this baseline grid. This gives you, and now why is this important? I think this tradition goes back to print as usual, when you've got paper, and paper is a bit translucent. So it's important that these lines are in the same line, you know, the ones on the back of the sheet of paper and the front of the sheet of paper. This way you've got, you don't have chaos, and also it improves legibility, because if you've got, you know, if this weren't the case, then you would have this black lettering being seen on from the other side of the page, and it really it doesn't look good. Also, if you've got, for instance, you know, the bottom of the page, it should be also always be on the same level. So these are the roots of this tradition, but I think it improves the overall design also, because it's a lot less chaotic if you've got the baseline grid, and if it all is designed on according to this. So when we design layouts that are a bit more complicated text-wise, that have more components, that have bigger text and smaller text, we need to do a, you know, a bit of calculations, not really very advanced math, but like finding the common denominator and the of a few numbers to have it all work. So that, like, you add this and this, and it's 2 times 12 and things like that. So these are things that a designer takes for granted, and it's normal. But then when I talk with developers, it turns out that they don't have something like the baseline. They have no way of really doing most of these things that for designers are very, very important. So again, with this little practice. Now, this is not so obvious, because many people would say that these are vertically aligned, because both of them are centered on the screen. And this is actually, but for a designer, for me, these are aligned. And for me, it looks better, but it's, you know, maybe it's just that I'm, you know, just not normal anymore. But when you look at this structure, what you really got is, you've got two boxes, and maybe they are defined by the line height of each of the elements, and you've got the text is centered vertically in both of the boxes. But when you've got this structure, which is for me superior, what you've got here is something that is actually quite strange. But the baseline is aligned. So it's not at all obvious for developers to do it this way, and actually we are still struggling within our team to find ways to make this work. And I know, but it really helps to know that this is a problem, because I used to like go over to the developers and ask them, well, why don't you align this text? And then I would go back after a couple of hours and it's still not aligned, and I would say, well, what's going on? And they would say, what are you talking about? Go away. And you know, and now I know that this is a problem for them, and they often don't understand what I mean when I say align the text. So I go into it, and sometimes we resolve how to do it, and sometimes we just, you know, don't do it when it's not very important. So also I compiled this little dictionary of words that are different but mean exactly the same thing. So because I thought it's useful just to know that these are the same, even though the words are different, but they mean exactly the same thing. So at first you might be confused in a conversation. Also, it's good to keep in mind that sometimes the units are different. For instance, the tracking, so the letter spacing in design programs, it's measured in 1/1000ths of an M. In the CSS, it's measured in M's. Okay, and I'd like to end with the notion of simple, because this is something that is very, very important, and you know, everybody wants to keep it simple, and everybody knows that we should do it in a simple way, and simple design is more legible, and simple code is good also, and so on. But it's not always that we understand, that we think the same things are simple. So maybe it will be more simple for me to say what is not simple, and what is not simple for designers. So for designers, there's a problem if there are a lot of elements, because even though there are ways in design programs to automate certain things, if you have to create a screen where there are 100 boxes, even if they look the same or almost the same, basically it boils down to the fact that you have to duplicate them and spread them around almost manually. So even if they are very, very consistent, just a lot of things is a lot less simple than one thing. And for developers, I suppose it's not like this, because if the things are identical, then you just code them once, probably. But for developers, the problem is where the things are, when the things are atypical. So if I've got 100 elements and I'm spreading them out, you know, in a design program manually, it doesn't hurt me almost at all if one of them, you know, I'll twerk it in this way, and one of them I'll just add some other color. You know, it's not really that much more work. But for a developer, suddenly this becomes a lot less simple and a lot more work. So it's I think important to keep in mind. Another thing that we came to the conclusion in the Superscript is that illustrations, this is something that a designer has to create. I mean, he actually has to draw all of these things that are later on the screen. So it's not simple. I mean, it takes time. But for developers, an illustration is just something that comes from above, is handed over to them, and appears on the screen. So it's like the most simple possible thing. Whereas animations for developers are not simple at all. I mean, they have to make these things move and move in certain ways. So we've had these situations in Superscript when we wanted to have an animated illustration, and they were saying, well, why don't you make an animated GIF and give it to me? And I was saying, no, come on, I would have to create manually like 50 frames. But you can just type probably two lines of code and, you know, just make it move. So we were having these discussions, and it's not always obvious what is the most time-effective way of resolving these problems. I think each time it might be different, but it's at least worth having in mind that sometimes, you know, that you don't have the whole picture. You see it from your perspective. You know what you have to do to make this work, but you don't know what the other side has to do. So it's not very easy sometimes to decide what will be the most effective way. And the last thing that is not simple for designers, and I can tell you that, is like when you've created this whole layout and you know, everything is decided more or less, and the developers come over and they look at it and they say, but why? Why did you put this here and not here? And what's the rule behind this? And what's the rule behind that? And when will these things behave in a certain way? And you have to create a set of rules that will govern these elements for like until the end of time. So, and this is, for me at least, one of the least simple phases of the design process. Whereas for developers, I think the lack of rules is the most problematic thing imaginable. So this is important also. We have to, as designers, force ourselves to create those rules and maybe create them with the help of developers as some kind of brainstorming. And because if we don't, then bad things will happen. So as some final examples here, this is a screenshot of a piece of the website that, from the developer's perspective, was quite simple. The boxes are almost the same, and they are laid out in a pretty like regular way. But for a designer, we had to illustrate 30 people from a team of something. So like, these illustrations took time. Someone had to draw out the glasses and the eyes and the everything. So this is one example, and another example would be of a website. This is an initial project, the initial design of a website, which I made, and like I was feeling playful, so I wanted sometimes the text to overlap the photos, and sometimes overlap them this way, and sometimes this way, but sometimes I wanted the photos to overlap the frame, and sometimes the frame to overlap the photo, and like, you know, it was really very cool, and I was excited by this. But then I showed it to the developers and they were asking a lot of questions. and why, how would we resolve this if the text is not legible on the photo, for instance? Because the client can put whatever photo he wants in that place. And what would be the rule behind deciding whether the photo overlaps the frame or the frame overlaps the photo. So like when I had to answer all of these questions, I kind of resigned a bit. And we ended up getting rid of this element of text overlapping the photo in this way. And we decided that one way of overlapping, that the colored frames always overlap the photos, would be the way that we do it. So in the process of creating the rules, we changed the design a bit to just, you know, to make it easier to create those rules that would govern it. So, you know, this communication, that's something that's ongoing in our team, and we talk more and more. And I think the most important part is to just acknowledge that you don't know a lot of things that the other side knows, and the other side doesn't know a lot of things that you know, and it's normal, you know. We have the different backgrounds, and that's the beauty of it. So I hope that, you know, as we communicate more and more, these boundaries will start to blur. Thank you.